From the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 6. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came for testimony, to bear witness to the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness to the light.
Our story begins with a miraculous conception in the first decade BC in a town of Judea.
Zechariah, a priest, enters the temple to burn incense.
Suddenly, the angel Gabriel appears before Zechariah, who is overcome with fear, but the angel says to him,
"Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John."
Now Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth are advancing in age. They believe it no longer possible to bear a child. In disbelief, even distrust, Zechariah questions the angel, saying,
"How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years."
Gabriel proclaims that Zechariah will remain silent until he sees that his words will be fulfilled. Elizabeth soon conceives.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, Gabriel appears to her cousin Mary and announces to her that she will bear God's son.
Though surprised by the angel's message, Mary trusts and accepts the Lord's will.
Mary then goes to visit Elizabeth, and at the sound of Mary's greeting, the baby in Elizabeth's womb leaps with joy.
The prologue to the Gospel of John says that John the Baptist was not the light, but came to testify to the light, to bear witness to it.
From the first moments of his life, his heart is ordered towards God.
His life will later be a testament to this witness, as God will use John's veracity to make his life an expression of love and truth.
The circumstances surrounding John and Jesus' conceptions illustrate how the Lord calls each and every person to holiness.
The Lord promises great things to his people, yet the greatest of these requires trusting God's providence, reflected in Elizabeth's response to their pregnancies.
Blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord.
John's story invites us to consider how we respond to God's call in our own lives, how each action we take might reflect love for God and love for one another.
When meditating on the visitation, Enuma Okoro writes that the interaction between Mary and Elizabeth illuminates the powerful act of simply standing as a witness to the trials and triumphs of another person's life, even amid one's own.
The solidarity will remain with us throughout our time together today. John the Baptist's life and death calls us to recognize the dignity of those we encounter and stand up for them, being with them even to the end.
Thank you. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 3, verse 1. In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, when he said,
"The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight."
30 years after John first testifies to Christ in his mother's womb, we see him bear witness once again, this time at the bank of the Jordan River. John has spent his adult life as a desert ascetic. He sustains himself only with desert locusts and wild honey, and protects himself with a leather girdle and a garment made of rough camel hair.
Meditating on this strangeness, Saint Remigius says, "In this clothing and this poor food, he shows that he sorrows for the sins of the whole human race."
A charismatic preacher, his message of repentance draws many to be baptized, and it is here, in the flowing Jordan, that John fulfills his role as the final and greatest of the Old Testament prophets, baptizing Jesus Christ.
Jesus, on his way from Galilee, approaches John, who recognizes him as the Anointed One, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.
Jesus then asks John to baptize him, and John remarks that he is not worthy to do such a thing. He even suggests a reversal, that Jesus, as the spotless Lamb of God, should be the one to baptize John.
Jesus, however, insists that it is fitting for John to baptize him. The scriptures then describe an incredible sight.
Jesus rises from the water, the heavens open, and the Holy Spirit, as a dove, descends on him.
A voice from heaven says, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased."
Baptismal waters cleanse a person of sin, allowing one to die to self and live for God. In baptizing Christ, John reveals Jesus as the Son of God, initiates Christ's ministry, and demonstrates baptism's centrality in the life of faith.
Christ's baptism makes one of the most difficult aspects of faith, true humility, extraordinarily palpable as John humbles himself in Christ's presence, and Christ himself is baptized not only as a sign of his obedience to the Father, but also in solidarity with God's chosen but sinful people of Israel.
The modern Christian, too, is baptized as an act of faith in Jesus Christ.
Baptism is a form of death, from which the newly baptized rise in the light of Christ, the same light to which John testifies.
Isaac Morales says that this baptismal entry into Christ's death serves as a foretaste of the future glory believers hope for, and it carries with it the consequences for how Christians are to conduct themselves in the world.
Baptism has important implications for the baptized, and John, who in his ministry calls his listeners to repentance, demonstrates how each action a believer takes might be ordered towards God.
Thank you. From the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verse 4. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying,
Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations.
Then I said, Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me,
Do not say I am only a youth, for to all to whom I send you, you shall go, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Be not afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord.
After Jesus' baptism, the next we hear of John is his imprisonment, learning that he has castigated Herod the Tetrarch, the ruler of Galilee, and his wife Herodias. Herodias was previously married to Herod's brother Philip, and divorced Philip to marry Herod.
John the Baptist publicly admonishes the marriage, as it violates Mosaic law on divorce. Angry and vengeful, Herodias wants John killed. Herod, however, believing John to be a just and holy man, spares his life, imprisoning him instead.
While in prison, John sends messengers to verify Jesus' miracles. In response, Christ not only confirms his work's legitimacy, but also affirms John's holiness to the gathered crowds, saying that among those born of women there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist.
Yet, in reiterating John, Jesus points to the message of the kingdom, saying that he who is the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John.
Jesus then poses a series of questions to the crowd. Why come out to the desert to see and hear John, without really listening to him? Why bother if unwilling to be changed?
His remarks might seem inflammatory. After all, he speaks in light of the unjust imprisonment of his cousin. Yet these questions reveal the reality of living in faith, that it is worth committing oneself to the good, even if the rewards cannot be reaped in this life.
John has committed his life to the good through his ministry.
And even when tested in the confines of his cell, he does not lose hope.
In a homily on John, Bede the Venerable says that John the Baptist preached the freedom of heavenly peace, yet was thrown into irons by ungodly men. He was locked away in the darkness of prison, though he came bearing witness to the light of life and deserved to be called a bright and shining lamp by that light itself, which is Christ.
John was baptized in his own blood, though he had been privileged to baptize the Redeemer of the world, to hear the voice of the Father above him, and to see the grace of the Holy Spirit descending upon him.
But to endure temporal agonies for the sake of the truth was not a heavenly burden for such men as John. Rather, it was easily borne, and even desirable, for he knew eternal joy would be his reward.
John seems remarkably out of place in his time, in our time, or indeed in any time. But this very out-of-placeness poses a challenge to his audience, both then and now, to live for the good, embracing the restlessness of the not yet.
Thank you. From the book of James, chapter 1, verse 2. Count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet various trials, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing.
Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation. Because like the flower of the grass, he will pass away.
For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flower falls, and its beauty perishes. So will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits.
Blessed is the man who endures trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him.
We now reach the climactic movement of our communal experience, John's beheading.
The details of the execution unfold rather quickly.
We learn that Herodias' daughter, Salome, dances for Herod and his guests on his birthday. As a reward for her dance, Herod offers her anything she desires.
Salome then goes to her mother Herodias, who in a fit of vengeance instructs her daughter to ask Herod for John the Baptist to be killed, and for his head to be returned on a platter.
In this scene, we witness the immeasurable darkness of his hatred, the consequences of sin on the human heart, complacency with evil, and the death of an innocent man.
In Herodias, we see the bitterness of wrath.
In Salome, corrupted youth.
In Herod, pride and self-importance.
And in Herod's guests, apathy.
Fleming Rutledge describes our age as one in which routine horrors take place. From widely publicized horrors like mass shootings that populate the news each week, to those that go unnoticed, like our neighbors dying without access to shelter, nourishment, or proper medical resources.
We witness John's beheading with horror, yet we too often grow numb to the injustices that pervade in our own time.
Rutledge goes on to say that the only cure for such an age is the intervention of God. That is what John the Baptist was sent to announce.
The voice of one crying in the wilderness calls out beyond his death, beyond his time, and into ours.
Thank you. some dictator or others had gone into exile. And now reports were coming about his regime. The usual crimes, torture, false imprisonments, cruelty and corruption. But then a detail, that the way his henchmen had disposed of their enemies was by hammering nails into their skulls. Horror! Then what does the mind do after horror? After that first feeling that you'll never catch your breath, mind imagines how not to be annihilated by it. The preliminary tap feels it in the tendons of the hands, feels the way you do with your nail when you're fixing something, making something, shelves, a bed, the first light tap to set the slant, then the slightly harder tap to embed the tip a little more. No, no more. This should be happening in myth, in stone, in paint, not in reality, and not here. This should be an emblem of itself, not itself, something that would mean not really to have to happen. Something to go out, expand an implication from that unmoved mass of matter in the breast, as in the image of an anguished face, in grief for us, not us, but us as in myth, a moral tale, a way to tell the truth that grief can be limitless, a way to tell us that we must always understand. It is we who don't do such things, we who set the slant, we who embed the tip, lift the sledge, and drive the nail which the axis upon which turns the brutal world upon the world.
From the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 1. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more.
And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying,
Behold, the dwelling of God is with men. He He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them.
He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away.
And he who sat upon the throne said,
Behold, I make all things new. Also he said,
Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true.
And he said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end.
To the thirsty, I will give from the fountain of the water of life without payment.
He who conquers shall have his heritage, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp.
Just as John anticipated Christ in life, so too would he anticipate Christ in death.
Christian tradition teaches us that after John's earthly ministry is completed, he goes to hell, where he preaches to the souls of the saints waiting Christ's salvation. They are free during the harrowing of hell, when Christ descends to hell to free the souls held captive there.
Jean Dernier writes that John was the man who gave up all other joys for the joy of hearing his Lord's voice. This is why he appears to us, cut off from all created things, a man set apart for this one great joy.
He knew what true joy was, and so could know no other. The Gospel tells us that Jesus received the news of John the Baptist's beheading in silence. When Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a lonely place apart.
We too end today in silence, following our reflection piece, Just As I Am. We will experience a few minutes of stillness. Let this be a moment of receptive openness and attentive silence.
In this place of stillness, let us become more aware of God's presence.
Let us be changed by the story of John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ.
Let us embrace the fellowship of those gathered in this place.
As you leave, drop your nail at the door.
Let the nail's crash, which will ring throughout the room, serve as a reminder of our humanity, how each of our actions can be transformed for the good.
And let your letting go serve as a reminder of what we owe to God, to ourselves, and to each other.